In the last tutorial, you learned how to create and save one simple Highscore value. In this one, we'll extend this to a full list including player names. So feel free to grab the project of Point Counter Episode 3 from the GitHub package. This is where we are going to start. Or just watch the video and adapt everything to your own needs. Let's create the basic UI before the coding part. At first, I'm going to remove everything from the single Highscore view. Since we want the Highscore as overlaying panel, we need a button for opening it. I just duplicate and rename the Start button. Now let's add a panel. I don't want it to span over the whole screen. A simple headline will do its job. And since we need to be able to close this panel, I add a very basic close button in the top right corner. Now we need to design how one entry in this list should look like. This will be our Highscore element and will be wrapped in an empty game object. One entry consists of a player name text and a point text. Size and style them as you want. I add a horizontal layout group to the element so they get aligned automatically. By increasing the size of the name and decreasing the size of the points, I arrange it appropriately. When you're done, you can save this element as prefab by dragging it into your prefabs folder. Now we want to have more than one entry, so let's create a parent element for this and drag the example element in there as a child. Add a vertical layout group, change its child alignment to upper center, and remove the checkbox for height at child force expand. If I now duplicate the entry, just to simulate several Highscore entries, you can see they will be aligned automatically from top to bottom. I can also see that 7 entries will fit nice in here. I remember this number for later, because this will be the max number of Highscore entries we can have. If you want, let's say 10, adjust the design as needed. Remove the duplicates, and you can leave one element for reference, but hide it, so it won't be visible anymore. Now we just need to be able to open and close this panel. In my scripts I already have this Highscore UI script from the previous episode. I can delete its content. We need a reference to our panel. I use a serialized field for this. Now we can add 2 public methods, one for opening the panel and one for closing it. By setting the object active and inactive, the functions perform the tasks. If you use my project as well, you now need to remove this line. This wants to call a method we just deleted. I comment it out for now. Assign recently created methods to the click handler on the open and the close button. If your script is not already attached to an object in your hierarchy, you need to add it to something like a manager object. And you also need to add a reference of the panel for the Highscore UI script. And I'm going to hide the panel so that it's closed by default. Now I can click the Highscore button, the panel opens, and I can close it again. It works nicely, but it's way too ugly. So let me fix this. I used this UI space pack from Kenny and improved the UI a little bit. It also comes with this font, which is quite nice, but the V's look a bit strange. So I guess my name is now Hillary or something like that. Now let's tackle the coding part. We are going to use code from another tutorial of mine, the storing data with JSON one. I highly recommend you to watch the video completely now. This will help you to understand why we are going to do certain things. If you don't want to, just grab the needed code out of the GitHub later on. Since we are going to store objects of a specific class, we need this one first. Create a script called HighScoreElement. We want an absolute basic C# class, so we can remove everything Unity related. Like we've seen in the front end, one HighScoreElement will consist of a name and a point value. Make sure your variables are public or at least serialized. The latter one also needs getters for later. I also add a constructor to define both values right on instantiation. for the saving and reading part later on, the whole class needs to be serializable. So add this line and the according import statement. I currently have a script called HighScoreElement. Since this handles the old HighScore, let's remove everything. Or just create one if you don't have it, of course. We don't want to save one HighScore entry, but rather a list of them, right? So this will be our first variable. A list of HighScore element. I also know that there is only space for 7 entries. So I create a variable for the max count of entries and set its default value to 7. This part is up to you. Save as many as you'd like to. We need methods for loading the list initially and for saving it whenever it was changed. The load part can happen on the start method of this class. Whenever a new point value was reached, we need to check if this could be a high score. So I create an according method for this, make it public. It will get the value of 1 high score element as parameter, so it knows the points and can add it to the list if it fits. Since we just deleted a method we call in the game handler script, you need to comment it out like we did earlier. So, about the storing JSON part. In the set tutorial, we created a quite universal usable script for this. It's called FileHandler. Get it from your other project or download it. There's a direct link in the description. I drag and drop it into my scripts folder. The script comes with methods for saving a list of objects or just a single object, as well as the reading equivalence. Note that this is a static class, so we call it directly by its class name. So let's do this. But beforehand, we need a file name, don't we? I add a serialized field for this. The saving part is a bit easier. We just need to call the writeToJSON method. As type definition, we'll use our HighScore element, because this is what we want to save. Now we can give the list of it, as well as the file name as parameter. The reading looks kinda like this. I'm going to replace the value of the HighScore list with the return value. That's fine, because we only read once on start. Use the same file name as parameter, of course. If the file does not exist, it will return an empty list, which is fine. But what if the file contains more entries than we want? For example, when we decreased the max count value. So let's remove every entry that is above the index of the max count. Be aware that once we save again, those values will be lost. Now we can compare the list of current high scores against the new point value, which we receive inside the addHighScoreIfPossible method. We create a for loop to get all the indices up to our max count, so we will never add anything above the max number. There are two cases in which we can add a new high score. If the position is empty, so no high score there. This can be checked if the count of the list is smaller than our current index. The other option, if the new points are greater than the one in the list, the high score should be added above. Simply do this by inserting the new element at the position of I. Inserting won't replace anything, which is what we want. Everything with an index higher than I slides back by 1. We just need to make sure to not have more entries than max count, like we did initially. Due to the changes to the list, we should save the current entries now. Then make sure to add a break statement, because every entry below the current one will have lower points, of course, and would therefore trigger this if statement. A break will completely skip the rest of the for loop. Now we can call this method whenever the point counting stopped. This is handled inside the GameHandler function, which just starts and stops it. To provide a player name, I will simply add a serialized field for this. Of course, you could have an input prompt, kind of like I did this in the storing data with JSON tutorial. Now I can call the reference of the HighScore handler script and the relevant function. For the parameter, I now need to instantiate a new object of HighScore element. I pass the player name as well as the points right into the constructor. In my case, the points come from the pointHat script, which shows the current point value in the front end and also stores the value. Back inside Unity, we need to add a few references. I add a player name, as well as the file name. Make sure to include the file type, which is in our case JSON. I can now start the game, let the points go up, and stop it. That will log the path to the newly created file, which I can now open. If everything worked, you should now see an entry like this in my case. To verify if reading also works, I'll stop my game and then start it again. It should now have read the current entry, and now I can add a second one. It should now override the file with the list, which contains the old and the new entry, like this. If your JSON file only contains empty brackets, check your code for some mistakes. Make sure you made your class serializable and that your variables are public, because an empty JSON file means there were errors on converting your object to a JSON string. So, now the last step is to show our entries in the UI, the HighScore panel. Inside our HighScore UI script, we need some more references. The first one is the prefab of one single entry. The second one will be the wrapper, the parent, which will contain all the single entries. Use transform as type instead of game object. To update existing entries when the HighScore list changes, we will keep track of them in a list of game objects. Now, let's create a private method, which will update the UI whenever it's called, based on the list it gets as parameter. We will now loop through all entries inside the list with a for loop, because we need the current index number I in another place. I save the current element in the temporary variable, just that it's better accessible. Just to make sure we don't show any HighScore entries with 0 points, I'll add an if statement for this. But the name could be empty. That's kinda how I remember those old games with the HighScore lists. Anyways, if we don't have any entry in our UI elements list, we instantiate a new object from the prefab. And only then, if it already exists, we can just change its text components. I instantiate a new object and right away set its parent to the wrapper element like this. Make sure to add false as value for the second parameter, so the element will keep its current transform value inside its parent. I forgot this here and added it later on. I can now add the element to our list, so that's anything inside of this if statement. Now we know that there exists an element in our UI elements list at position I. I can now grab all the text components from the children, which will be 2, the player name and the points. Make sure you use the method with an S, getComponents, to receive an array back. If you created a new script, make sure to add the UnityEngine.ui package to your imports. I know that the first one is the player name, so I can just set its text. The second one is our points value. Convert the integer to a string. The order matches the order in your hierarchy. But there is one question. When does this method get called? So basically, we could have made it public and just call it from inside the HighScore handler. That's an option. But what if we would like to have some other things to trigger when a new HighScore was added? Like balloons and fireworks. So let me show you how you can handle this via Unity, Delegates and Events. You can subscribe to a method. When this method gets called, like the event is triggered, all the subscribers get fired. So I added this delegate in the first line. Every parameter you want the subscribers to receive needs to be inside the brackets, like this list here. The second one is a static event. This kind of wraps around the delegate. Based on this event, we can add and remove methods from the invocation list, but this later. At first, we need to fire the event. This will happen in 2 places, when loading initially and when adding a new value to the list. Before invoking an event, you need to check if it is null beforehand. If it is not, we can invoke it like this. But this will give an error since we don't pass any parameters. But we need to. So let's add our list. You can now copy and paste it right above our break inside this method. So inside our HighScore UI, we can now subscribe to this event. Do this in your onEnable function. We call the HighScore handler directly by its class name. We don't need a reference, since our event is static. With a plus equal, you can now add the method you want to be called. Make sure to do the opposite in your onDisable method, now with a minus equal, to remove this method again. This will prevent potential memory leaks. Back in Unity, assign the needed references to the HighScore UI script. When I now start the game, the two values I added beforehand are now visible in the panel. Wonderful! I'll add another one. And another. Oh. At this point, I realized it's not possible to start a second time. For the ones of you who use my code, just follow this quick fix by setting the game stopped value back to false. Since the counter is still up, we also need a reset method. This will modify the variable directly to prevent the visible point counter change. So, now that this works, I added some more values. You can see there won't be any more than my max count of 7. Having a value as high as another one will always append the new one. If you want the new value to be at the top, just change this part in the code to a greater equals. That's it for this tutorial, but there is still a lot you can improve. Besides the obvious, like creating an input field for the player name, or the well-needed fireworks, there is also not much error handling, especially on side of the file handler. But I already mentioned this in its own tutorial. But I hope it helped you and gave you a better understanding and feeling on how to work inside and with Unity. If you enjoyed the content, consider liking and subscribing, and I'll see you next time.